You can get it if you really want. You can get it if you really want. You can get it if you really want. But you must try, try and try, try and try. You'll succeed at last. Persecution, you must.
Hello, I'm Keith Howes, and I was the features editor of London Gay News from 1976 until 1979. And I've had some interesting questions recently asked about my time at Gay News, so I thought I'd like to share those questions and my answers with you. I think the history of Gay News, the early history of Gay News, is probably better discussed by someone that was there at the start. There were certainly challenges in terms of getting the paper into WH Smith's, which was the largest newsagent chain in England. And of course, for quite some time after the initial stocking by WH Smith, they did ban the paper, which of course cut down the number of sales. So that was a challenge. I think it was a challenge for Dennis to keep the thing together. It started as a collective. Collectives are always a challenge because people have different viewpoints. Dennis basically took the collective and threw it out and started very much a hierarchical process with him as the editor. And of course it was a challenge. Putting out a paper which came out twice a month, 25 issues a year on a very limited budget, and starting off with staff who were generally not trained journalists. They learnt on the job, and the actual typesetting had to be done on a very old machine. The design, the layout was done with Letraset, which is not the way that's done now. Yeah, very crude methods, but beautiful results because of the dedication of the people that were in the employ of Gay News. Was it harder to get interviews with people for the gay press as distinct from the magazine press that I've been working before? Yeah, when I worked for She magazine, it used to be that the editor of She would be at a dinner party, or she'd be looking through a newspaper. She'd see someone that was up and coming and interesting, or someone that was an established person, and she'd just ring me up and say, "Keith, I'd like you to interview this young singer. His name's Elton John. He lives in Virginia Water. There'll be a car ready for you to go over and meet and interview him." So, of course, it was a luxurious life working for a national magazine because I had all the facilities laid on. At Gay News, there was no car. You had to use public transport in the main to get to places. It was a very humble building that we're in. The office that I was working in was tiny, minute. I was sharing it with smokers, which wasn't too much fun. At the beginning, it was difficult to get interviews because a lot of the people were very wary about putting their clients or themselves into a gay setting. They didn't know what sort of questions they'd be asked. But once I proved myself to be a very competent interviewer and a good journalist, more and more people lined up to come. And of course, it was very good publicity for their shows, their plays, their musical concerts. And it was much easier. After the first few months, it was much, much easier. And of course, after the blasphemy case, the paper was really notorious, well known, so we got more and more cooperation. But there were still people who didn't want to play. Elton John didn't want to, Dirk Bogarde didn't want to, Cecil Beaton didn't want to, John Gielgud, and surprisingly, or maybe not surprisingly, Vanessa Redgrave, who isn't gay, but of course her father was gay, bisexual, and her husband had been gay. So maybe those are the reasons that she dodged our interviews. I think I've answered that question, but I will answer it again. How did working for Gay News compare working with a mainstream place? Well, in terms of facilities, it was pretty cramped accommodation, very limited machinery that we had to work on. I mean, certainly laughable by today's standards. Of course, no computers, no sophisticated graphic techniques. It was all done by hand. All the paper was actually printed on boards. We had to paste all the articles and photographs on boards before the boards were packed up and sent off to Norfolk so that they'd come back the following Tuesday from Thursday. It was very primitive, certainly very primitive, and it was not the easiest situation. And we had to employ a lot of freelance people, some of whom hadn't written very much before. But and we couldn't pay them very much money. We had very limited resources financially, but of course we were there for the cause. You know, the cause. Gay is good. Yeah, if I could go back in time, what would I have done differently at Gay News? I would have done more in-depth articles. We did a few in-depth articles. We did one on alcoholism, which I spent a lot of time, did a lot of research on gays and lesbians and alcoholism. In fact, one of our staff had been an alcoholic and she went to AA, and she was actually Dusty Springfield's contact when Dusty was in England and Dusty was finding it difficult to deal with the drinking. She would ring up Joe and talk it over. So that was something. I wish we could have done more on the environment. I wish we could have done more on gays in the country, gays actually working in the community, more political stuff in that sense. But of course, we were limited to time and resources. We weren't at all limited by the scope of Gay News. We could have written about anything, as long as it had, of course, the gay angle. I was not at Gay News when Gay News collapsed in 1983, but of course I was in touch with some of the people who were involved, and it was a very, very tumultuous time for them. They really hoped they'd be able to keep it going. The person that bought the paper from Dennis Lemon was seemingly not perhaps the best person to have bought it. There were all sorts of mistakes made. I mean, if people want to find out what the atmosphere was like, they should read the book The Fight for Gay News by Andrew Lumsden. Andrew Lumsden was actually one of the progenitors of Gay News, and he came back in the latter years and actually worked as, I think, the editor. I'm not sure. The atmosphere was incredibly bitter, actually, and there are people today I know who don't really want to think about Gay News anymore because the dream had ended. And it was a bit of a dream, you know. It's sort of like all idealistic things. It has probably the seeds of its own destruction. In a way, I was really glad that I wasn't involved on a day-to-day basis. And on the other hand, I suppose I was a bit regretful that I'd given up the fight. Because it was a fight to keep the paper, not pure exactly, because it wasn't a religious paper, but away from the mainstream materialism, which I fear has become very much a part of gay culture today. My favourite interview, well, of course, I loved Dame Edna Everidge. Well, a dream, because I didn't have to ask her any questions. She basically did the whole thing. David Hockney, I loved. David Hockney was an idol of mine and one of the few people who actually lived up to everything that I thought. But I had to interview him twice. I made such a balls up for the first interview. I had to go around to his place a second time, and it all went swimmingly after that. But most of the interviews were really good. The worst interview would have to be, I suppose, the diva whose behaviour and demeanour I found totally objectionable and disagreeable, and indeed the interview was canned and it never saw the light of day, so that's probably a very good thing. In the main, I found people extremely cooperative and helpful. They loved, in the main, the idea of being interviewed for a gay newspaper. It was different, very different to what they'd expected, and also to have questions and have someone listen in a way and not ram opinions down their throats. But I love the You Tell Us. I love going to Gay Britain. I love going around Britain talking to gay people. It was a privilege. The whole 4 years was a privilege, actually. My favourite memory of Gay News, well, it's a wicked memory, actually, and it relates to John Christopher Travers, who was the resident astrologer. John Christopher Travers was known as Merlin, and he was a very naughty boy. He was a Gemini, and what he used to do was he used to go up and down the country giving talks to Campaign for Homosexual Equality groups. And in these talks, he would talk all about astrology and how important it is in gay relationships. Afterwards, he'd eye some gorgeous young man and find out what this young man's sign was and say, ah, perfect. Geminis, because he was a Gemini, and whoever this person was and which sign he belonged to, are made for each other, and it's really important that he connects with so-and-so. So that's the way he would get his boyfriends, bed partners, by using astrology. So in about 1978, the Pope died. Pope Paul died, and Pope John Paul was elected as Pope. And so we asked John Christopher Travers, Merlin, to do a astrological summary of this Pope's influence. What was this Pope going to do, particularly in relation to gay rights within the Catholic Church? And so John Christopher wrote this piece all about the new Pope and how he's going to go back to the origins of Christianity and the roots of what Jesus wanted. But of course, unfortunately, this Pope died. And there was a phone call the next morning with a very sheepish Merlin on the phone saying, could I have my copy back, please? Because of course we couldn't print it because the Pope had died and there was no mention in Merlin's astrology of any illness or sudden death. I think it was wonderful. My worst memory, well, I suppose my worst memory was when I had the severance from Gay News. It was very unfortunate. There was a situation where Dennis Lemon said that the paper had lost confidence in me and that maybe I should become a roving reporter stuck out in the Shetland Islands or something like that. In other words, my time had come. I exploded, told Dennis everything I thought of him, which had been building up really since the publication of the poem, and immediately typed out my resignation. So I was basically, cutting myself off from my family, my gay family at Gay News. And I remember I walked, after handing in the resignation, which of course Dennis accepted very quickly, I remember walking, I think, through Soho and passing a record shop, and there was some music playing, some jazz music, and it was really haunting. And I went into the shop in my sad and disheveled state and asked, what was the name of the album that was playing? And they said, it's called Continuum. And at that moment, I knew everything would be all right, and that, of course, there was a continuum because I kept on writing theatre reviews and TV reviews for Gay News until it ended. I was, at the end, writing interviews. So in a way, I never really left Gay News. I just continued. Thank you. Thank you.